Let us analyze what the cost of computing the Kolesky factorization is. Okay, so over here we have the algorithm. And what we're going to do is analyze what the cost of one iteration is, a typical iteration, and then we're going to look at how to sum it over all iterations. Now, in a typical iteration, this matrix here is k by k. Okay? This is one row, and that makes this n minus k minus 1 rows. Okay? And importantly, this right here is an n minus k minus 1 by n minus k minus 1 matrix. Okay, with that, we can analyze what the cost of the different parts are. Now, we can get into an argument about how many floating point operations are required to do a square root, but it turns out that's going to be a lower order term, so we don't care. Similarly, we can argue about how exactly to do this. Should we divide 1 by alpha 1, 1, and then multiply that times the vector, or should we just divide into the vector? But it turns out that's not where the computational expense is anyway, so we're not going to worry about that either. This is where the computational expense is. Okay, now this here is an outer product, so we're updating matrix A22 with an outer product. We call that a rank 1 update. But notice that we only need to update the lower triangular part of that. Now, if we take any one entry here and we ask ourselves the question, how is that entry updated? Notice that that entry is updated by multiplying the appropriate entry of A21 times the appropriate entry of A21 Hermitian transpose, and then subtracting that off of A22. So that takes a multiply and a subtract. That's two floating point operations. We're just going to count that as two and not get into the argument whether if these were complex valued matrices, how exactly we should count that. That's two. So for every entry we do two, if we were updating the full matrix, that would mean two times n minus k minus one squared floating point operations. But because we only have to update half of the matrix, we perform approximately half of those. Okay? So this is where the major expense is in a typical iteration. So now we need to add that expense over all iterations. And notice that in the first iteration, k is 0, so this matrix is 0 by 0. In the next iteration, it's 1 by 1, k is equal to 1, and so forth. So what that means is that we want to do the sum from k equals 0 to n minus 1 of this expense right here, which we can write as n minus k minus 1 squared, because the 2's cancel. Okay? Then what we can do is say, well, if we do a clever substitution, change a variable where we say j is equal to n minus k minus 1, then we can write this as the sum from j equals 0. Let's see. When k is equal to 0, j is equal to n minus 1, so we'd have to go from n minus 1, and when k is equal to n minus 1, j is equal to 0 of j squared. But, you know, we kind of prefer writing our sums going forward, incrementing at every step, so we can write that as such. Now, what I then do is I ask Maggie, what is the result of this? And then she tells me and we're done. But you typically don't have the luxury of doing that. So there is a trick that we then remember. And the trick is that this is approximately equal to the integral from 0 to n of, x squared dx. All right? And that, we know, is x cubed over 3 evaluated between 0 and n. And that tells us that the cost is approximately n cubed over 3. Now, you may remember that if you compute the LU factorization of a square matrix, that cost is actually 2n³/3, approximately. So we see that the Kolesky factorization requires roughly half the number of computations as does the LU factorization.